Mission Point. Hey, is God good today? Let's all stand up. Man, look at these kids this morning. I hope they're a little bit more excited than some of y'all this morning. All right? Hey, if you've been fighting a battle, if you got an issue going on this morning, we're here for you today. And this song says the battle belongs. It's not our battle, but it's Jesus Christ today.
Water, earth, and sky. galaxy. You are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy, holy. God of wonders beyond our
God speaks to us. You know, who's going in here going through the new discipleship class? Raise your hand. Ooh, good. We got people throughout the whole church going through discipleship class. It's been talking about God speaking to you and God working through you. And let me tell you what, I feel like God's been speaking to me through this discipleship class. And if none of you all are wanting to go through this, if some of y'all want to go through it, it's a 10-week new course that we are offering here at the church. Our teens are going through it. We got young adults going through it. We have a lot of people throughout our church going through this program. You know, sometimes you find yourself at a crossroad and you don't know what to do with it. And this is what this song kind of talks about, is that when you open up that Bible and it becomes life to you, and it points you into that direction where, man, I've been going down this road, and maybe it's not the right road I've been going to. How do I find direction? And I want to tell you, through these discipleship classes that we're starting to offer here at the church, it's really giving people hope and direction. So as we sing this morning, hopefully this ministers to your life. It says, Word of God, speak.
Finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Still and know that you're in this place.
Be seated this morning. Awesome. We got some good things going on at Mission Point, don't we? God is good this morning. Why don't you give a round of applause for our praise team this morning? Amen. All right, a couple quick announcements here. Walking angels. We have walking angels. If you are a senior citizen in our church and you want to get in shape and fit, hey, we have a program for you. 9 a.m. on Tuesdays and Thursdays, they come and meet, they pray, and they walk around the gymnasium. When it's nice outside and the weather's getting nicer, they will all be probably going outside. Volleyball fellowship. We had a good turnout on last Monday night. Next one will be the first Monday of the month, so we just on the first and third Monday of each month, starting at 7 p.m. Ages 18 to 35, we take high schoolers, whatever, I get some 40-year-olds, but hey, we have a great time. All right, Young Adult Fiesta is coming up. That is going to be on May 5th. That is at 6 p.m. That's at mine and Laura's house, so if you are a young adult and you're wanting to get involved, ages 18 to 35-ish, okay. Get with me. Okay, Mother's Day banquet is coming up. They're going to be selling tickets this coming Sunday, April 28th. Also, this event will be taking place at Der Dutchman Saturday, May 11th from 5 to 7 p.m. All right, Tom Kraft, where are you this morning? Oh, he's standing out there. I was going to have him announce the Band of Brothers trip. It didn't work out. All right, he got on Pastor last week. He was like, hey, you didn't announce the Band of Brothers trip. Well, now he's out there. Man, I was going to have him do this. All right, Band of Brothers trip. Okay, this is going to be from May 15th through 18th. This is from a Wednesday through Saturday. Cost is $85. If you're going Thursday through Saturday, it is $75. It includes amazing lodging. Also includes meals. Why are some of you women laughing when I say that? All right, it's an inside joke. All right, life groups. If you have never been in a life group before, we'd love to have you at our life groups on Sunday night. They start at 6 p.m. We have some that are held in houses and some that are here on location. Greg Pugh, can you raise your hand? He is a life, he does it. Tom's out there. So Shelly, raise your hand. Thank you. Dan, Pastor Dan, we all have life groups on Sunday night. We'd love to have you come back. If you have nothing to do on a Sunday night, please come back out here. Also, social media, like us on social media. That is Facebook, Instagram. We have private pages for different things that we have for missions and young adult stuff. I don't know what all Tiffany has out there. YouTube, everything else like that. Like us. Get us out there. Hey, children, you all look amazing this morning. You all can go to kids worship.
All right. Yeah, I do have to humble myself. Doug and Tom told me last Saturday not to forget to announce it on Sunday. And so come Sunday, I forgot. I have like an elephant's brain. Nothing escapes us. I don't forget to announce anything. So, all right. One quick announcement I did forget. Next Sunday, we're having a missionary, Calvin Hauser. He'll be here. He is our missionary to the Philippines. He is going to give us an update on what's happening in his ministry across the world. And so he'll be here to give us that update and give us a good challenge from the Word of God. So make sure you're here to support him. Open your Bibles to Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2. We're going to finish up this chapter today talking about models of spiritual maturity. We're talking about setting good examples. We need more people to set good examples. Examples take us where just having principles cannot. I can take a recipe card and I can follow the recipe. Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. Must not be going fast enough. All right. All right, I'm moving. All right. So anyway, I may not be able to take a recipe card and follow that recipe to be a good cook, and at the end, it may not look like the picture, but there are things that you can glean from those things. I may not be able to watch Gordon Ramsay or Emeril or Bobby Flay or any of those Rachel Ray or any of those cookers. I may not be able to watch one program and then go and open my own 5-star restaurant. But I can listen to what they say and what they do, and it might help me to cook better. And so the idea is that we need more visible examples because they take us where principles do not. And so not only do we need Christians to exemplify biblical principles to other Christians, but we need to show this to the world. The world needs to see this because we're losing our impactful examples into the world. David Livingstone was a missionary in the 1700s to Africa. And matter of fact, there's a lot of Christians, if you don't know, throughout missionary work, as they spread the gospel through Africa, they actually mapped out the continent of Africa. And so David Livingstone was one of those as well. He took and mapped out a lot of uncharted lakes and rivers and all the geography there. But it was one thing that he did for his part of Africa that he worked in is he helped to eliminate slavery. Now, they in 1802, they abolished slavery in parts of Africa, but they continued to practice it. So he was someone who went out and actually put it into practice to stop it. William Carey, he was a missionary to India. And so with other missionaries that were with him, he helped abolish infanticide. So according to Hindu religion and parts of India that he was missionary to, what they would do is they would take their babies, if they had more than one, they would take one of their children and they would throw them into the river to sacrifice the baby to the river. And so everybody practiced that. And so they went in. Matter of fact, William Carey Jr. told a story while they were on the boat one time on the river, and they saw this child just suffering to live, and they took the boat up, and they picked the child up, and they went ashore, and they went to give the child back to the mother, and he recalls that she broke the child's neck and threw it back in the river. And so William Carey took it upon himself and other missionaries, and they literally got infanticide abolished in the country. We need more people like this. He helped them eliminate sati. Sati was where the husband died. This was a religious thing so that the husband and wife could have eternal blessing, and the family that was left on earth would be blessed. And so what happened is when dad died, he would be set afire, his bones would be set on fire, and they would throw the wife on top of him, alive. It was called sati. And the kids wanted the blessing, so you make sure you go and read the stories, man. They had knives and stuff, and they're like, you're jumping on there, whether you want to or not. And women began to run, and they began to hide as soon as the husband died. So what they would do is later on they began to dig ditches, deep ones. And they would throw the husband in there and set him on fire and then push the wife in. There was no way that she could get away from it. And so William Carey helped abolish that in that country. They put lepers to death. As soon as you got leprosy, you'd be put to death. You'd be drowned in the river. So family would disown them, society would disown them, and they'd be put to death. So William Carey did a great job of eliminating that in the country. And so he also did slavery as well. And he took that back to England, and he helped abolish slavery there along with other missionaries. And it was an ongoing process. Jim Elliot, this man lost his life to the tribe that he was trying to witness to. And amazingly enough, 3 years later, his wife, some of the other wives of the murdered men, one sister, and I think a daughter of Jim's, went and lived among the Warani tribe. And they came to the saving knowledge of Jesus. And they became a peaceful tribe. but all of their husbands lost their lives. This is, look, we don't see things like that in our country. I mean, we don't have cannibals. We don't have sati. We don't drown lepers. We do have a problem with infanticide, but we don't drown children in the river. We call it abortion. Even though we have eliminated systemic slavery, and we're trying to continue our efforts to do so, we don't enslave somebody based on the color of their skin or their race, but we do have a problem with slavery in our country. It's called human trafficking. We have sex slaves that are absolutely coming out of our country nonstop. The numbers are increasing phenomenal. And what you may not know in my article is outdated, but it was January of 2023. The state of Ohio was fifth in sex trafficking victims. We're fifth among 50 states. That's amazing. Absolutely amazing. We have a drug epidemic in our world. Now, we're not going to eliminate drugs, period. Revelation chapter 18 says that drugs are the end times deceiver. It is going to deceive the nations as drug use. But we got to be careful. Listen, we need more people to set good biblical examples for people to follow. The world needs to see that. We need to show them something different. It's going to help our world. It's hard for our society to see models of self-sacrifice. They don't want to sacrifice. They want everybody to do for them. We need more Christian politicians. We need more Christian mayors, lawyers, governors, police officers, military folks, pet groomers, hairstylists. I don't care. We need more people to set the examples out into the world. We need to show them how good this world could be. If God's principles isn't going to make this world better, then don't do it. But if it is, then we need to show them something different. They don't see that. They don't have that. We know Jesus is absolutely the best example. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 20, the NASB says it this way: God is making his appeal through us. We beg you on behalf of Christ. Jesus isn't here physically. He's not here visibly. 2,000 years ago, he came, lived a sinless life. He was here. They listened to his teaching. He's not here. We are his representatives. We need to set the example for people to follow. Paul set that example. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 1. The Living Bible says it this way, the TLB. And you should follow my example just as I followed Christ. Paul followed Christ. Timothy followed Paul. Paul followed Jesus. That's why Timothy followed Paul. So we have two people following Christ because each one followed each other, but they both followed Jesus. We need more examples like that. Timothy was like-minded. He was concerned for other people. Wasn't just looking out on his own interest, but on the interest of Christ. And then you come to this next guy, Epaphroditus. That's a funny name, gentlemen. So if you're in Philippians chapter 2, let's finish this chapter, verse 25 through 30. Paul writes this: I have thought it necessary to send to you Epaphroditus, my brother, fellow worker, and fellow soldier, and your messenger and minister to my need, for he has been longing for you all and has been distressed because you heard that he was ill. Verse 27, indeed he was ill near to death, but God had mercy on him, and not only him, but on me also, lest I should have sorrow upon sorrow. I am the more eager to send him, therefore, that you may rejoice, all seeing him again, and that I may be less anxious. So receive him in the Lord with all joy. Honor him, such men, for he nearly died for the work of Christ, risking his life to complete what was lacking in your service for me. Let's open with a word of prayer, and we'll get into this context here this morning. Tim Bongiorno, would you open us in a word of prayer, please? Amen. Thank you. We really don't know anything about Epaphroditus except his name means loved of Aphrodite. So we can superimpose that he was probably a Greek who grew up pagan. His mom and dad was probably Greek. Give him this name. And so he had origins in Greek and pagan lifestyle. But The Apostle Paul was chained to a soldier at this point, and so he was on house arrest. He couldn't go out and do ministry. He couldn't go out and work as a tent maker. So the Philippian church, what they wanted to do is they wanted to bring him some money. They wanted to give him a monetary gift. So evidently this man Epaphroditus had gotten saved. And so he was a Christian who they loved dearly. So they sent Epaphroditus. Here's a monetary gift for Paul. You go and give this to him and you stay with him as long as it takes to help him meet his needs. So they sent this guy out from the church. And so look at verse 25. Let's go through this quick. We'll go through these verses and finish this chapter up this morning. He says, I've thought it necessary to send to you Epaphroditus, my brother. He calls him a brother first. So evidently, he must have accepted Jesus as Lord and Savior. At some point, he placed his faith and trust in Christ. And anybody who does that becomes a brother or sister. Amen? You're all brothers and sisters in Christ. And so we're all one. That's what we do in a baptism. We give them is it your profession? Have you accepted it? Yes. Well, I baptize you now, my brother or my sister. And then we do the dunking. But evidently he was converted at some point from his Greek pagan culture into Christianity. Second thing he calls him is a fellow worker. A fellow worker. A fellow worker is somebody who comes alongside and works with the extension of the gospel in the ministry of the church. A co-worker, so to speak. We need more examples of brothers and sisters who are Christians to come alongside the church and help do the ministry by getting the gospel out to other people and setting the example, discipling them and being discipled and all that stuff. We need help with those things. That's what a fellow worker is. That's what a co-worker is. He helps you do the work, your job that you're supposed to do. And then he calls him a soldier. He's my brother, my fellow worker, and a fellow soldier. Now, Epaphroditus was battling not only physical people, but he was battling the demonic realm, a spiritual realm that's unseen for sure, and he was in a battle. Anybody that's going to go out and give the gospel to people in the world and try to disciple them, you're going to be in a battle. And so we're going to be soldiers, and we're going to be in a battle raging for the kingdom. And I think we forget sometimes that we're facing a real enemy. Not physical. Matter of fact, Paul says in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12, for we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but against rulers, against authorities, against cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in heavenly places. We don't have a physical enemy. It's a spiritual enemy. And boy, does he love us to attack the physical, doesn't he? That's why it's so important to put on the armor of God. We need God's protection. We need to put it on every day. Back to verse 25 and 26. He says, I thought it necessary to send you Epaphroditus. He's my brother. He's my fellow worker. He's my soldier. And he was the Philippians' messenger and minister to Paul's need. For he has been longing for you all and has been distressed because you heard that he was ill. They heard that he wasn't doing well. They heard that he had some type of illness, whether it was physical or it was a persecution. We'll talk about that in a minute. But he had distress. Actually, the word's translated anxiety. He was so anxiety or distress because those people cared so much about him. They were worried about him in the ministry. We have that problem in our society. We don't care about people. We care more about stuff and things. Amen? We need to show a society that we're genuinely concerned for people. And so this is what aggravated Epaphroditus so bad, as he knew that church back there was worried about him. And he didn't want them to worry. He knew that they knew he was sick. And so it upset him to the point to where it made him sick. Not that that was the sickness he had. Verse 27, 28. Paul says, indeed, he was ill near to death, but God had mercy on him, and not only him. See, Paul's writing this when Epaphroditus is right there with him. So they don't have the letter yet. He's getting ready to bring it back to him. So they don't know any of those things. So he's kind of writing to them, telling them why he's sending him back. He said he was sick almost to death. God had mercy on him. Not only him, but he said, me also. lest I should have sorrow upon sorrow. I am more eager to send him, therefore, that you may rejoice at seeing him again, and that I may be less anxious. Paul was like, I have anxiety because I don't want problems with the church. You thinking that he's going to die, and then I got to get him back to you so that it can calm you guys down. This is, lest I have sorrow upon sorrow. Everybody needs to know what's going on so the situation is put to rest so everybody calms down. We react out of emotion way more than what we should. Amen? Hello? Don't get the emotion of falling asleep. I'll make you stand up and do jumping jacks. One of these days, I'll literally do that. All right, look at verse 29 to 30. Let's finish up with these. These are all important verses here. He says, receive him in the Lord with all joy and honor such men, for he nearly died for the work of Christ, risking his life to complete what was lacking in your service to me. The word receive there means to welcome in with open arms, to embrace with open arms. It's not the fact that he wanted them to receive him back. He wanted them to know, look, take this guy back with joy. He did not fail you. They sent him out. Here is a monetary gift for Paul, and you stay there and you help him. Help him do whatever he needs to do. And so Paul's sending him back with this letter, and they're like, what are you doing back here? We sent you to go help Paul. So Paul has to write in this letter, hey, here's Epaphroditus. He's okay. He was sick unto death. Everything's okay. Calm down. Accept him. Receive him back. He's not a failure. He didn't fail. So just have joy. It's all okay. And then he says that he almost died for the work of Christ. Almost died for working for Jesus. How do you almost die for working for Jesus? I know in verse 27 he said he was sick. And I don't want to get into the verse, but it could mean that he was physically sick. He had some type of disease. He had some type of illness. He had some type of physical affliction that come upon him. That is a possibility. Because that word sickness isn't like we have in ours, in our English language. That word can mean many different things. So he could have been physically sick, had some type of affliction, some type of disease. It could have meant that he had... I don't say that people get sick to the point of death from, I guess you could. You don't get sick in ministry working for Jesus like some pastors do. They get the stress of the church. Paul had anxiety over all the churches because he cared for them so much. And you get stress and anxiety. You can have, you know, ulcers and so forth. And yes, you can have physical afflictions. But I don't know that it would be to the point of death. I guess it could be. Stress could, you know, wear your heart out. I don't know. It could have been that as well. But he's working for the ministry. He's working for Christ. And he's risking his life to complete what was lacking. And so I think in some respects, he was literally putting his life on the line. Not in so much as a sickness, but putting his life on the line because Jesus said, don't marvel that the world hates you because it first hated me. So if you're Jesus' representative, the world's going to hate you. Amen? And so he's putting his life on the line for Jesus. And so this word also, sick, is translated as weak or feeble. And this could be the case here as well. And so Paul's talking about being sick to the point of death. Matter of fact, in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 10, Paul says, for the sake of Christ, I'm content with weaknesses, with insults, hardships, persecutions, calamities. For when I am weak, then I am strong. He's talking about people and things coming upon him physically from an outside influence. And so that word weakness is the same word translated as sickness in verse 27 of Philippians 2. So we see some similarities. Weakness had put him in a bad spot in a godless society who didn't want nothing to do with Jesus. And so it could have, he risked his life. It could have taken his life. And he worked in the ministry to the point of death. And so this man simply came close to martyrdom. Matter of fact, Paul was eventually martyred. He was beheaded for his faith in Jesus. Throughout his ministry, he was stoned, left for dead, whipped, lashed, shipwrecked, bitten by a poisonous serpent. He had all kinds of afflictions happen to him. But he was still doing it for the cause of Christ. Matter of fact, in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, Jesus says this, "You will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses." You know what that word witness is from the Greek? It's the Greek word martis. That's where we get our English word martyr from. It means someone who gives their life as a witness. That's a martyr. That's a witness. It's the same thing. Back to verse 30. He says, "For he nearly died for the work of Christ, risking his life to complete what is lacking in your service for me." There's a phrase there, risking his life. And I don't know anything about English, let alone Greek. But Greek is a little different than our English language. English language, I think you have like a noun, and then you have a verb, and then the verb describes the action the noun's doing and all that stuff. It's a little different in the Greek. Makes it more crystal clear of what's being talked about. So the same word that's used in the noun form is the same word that's used in a verb form. And so the phrase risking his life actually literally means dice. So it's dice, but it's the Greek word parabola. And it's used in the verb sense, which means this: you're rolling the dice. So rolling the dice means that you are a gambler. You're gambling, not physically gambling, but you're exposing yourself to danger. You're gambling with your life. That's the whole idea of what he's trying to say. And he was loyal. He was faithful. He put his life on the line for the work of Christ. Interesting story. After the New Testament writers had all died off and they began to spread the Gospels and all of the Scripture around to different churches, they actually handwrote their own copy. And so they would distribute to every church and they would write their own copy and then they'd give them back the original. And so that's why we have copies of copies of copies, and they're 99.5% accurate with all the copies we have. Very dependable Word of God. Amen? And so these people are writing their own copies here. And so as they come about, after the New Testament writers had passed on in the first couple centuries, there was a group of people associated, just men and women associated with the church, and their name was Parabolani, which means the gamblers. And actually, they took this name, and their hero, their founder, as they called it, was Epaphroditus. Because he was a gambler. He was a person who took risks. And so these people that took it upon themselves, their mission was to go into prisons, visit people that were sick, had very deadly, destructive diseases and all kinds of infections. And so they were bold to proclaim the name of Jesus to everybody they come in contact with, regardless of hesitation of their environment. The gamblers. Another name for, you know, gambler be like a risk taker. In our culture, we really don't have risk takers, do we? We don't take risks, right? We're trying to eliminate as many risks as we possibly can. Isn't that what we do? Don't we save money for a rainy day? Don't we invest money so we can have some for this? Don't we have insurance, like insurance just in case something happens to our car? That way the car is covered. You have health insurance just in case something happens to you, you're covered. We're trying to eliminate all the risks in life, right? I got my burglar alarm on. I got the cameras outside. Boy, I'm taking care of every risk that I have. I got my fence in here to keep all my stuff protected. And if that doesn't happen, then I got my cameras. I'll show all these people. We try to eliminate risks all the time. But these people were risk takers. They put themselves in harm's way. They put themselves in positions to get the gospel out no matter what. It's something different for us. Where's our risk takers? Where is our sacrificial people doing the work of the ministry? We need more examples of this. You guys want to head up? We need more examples of this. The first thing you want to do is eliminate this risk. This is the one where everything else is hopefully going to be irrelevant, but the eternal risk. In Romans chapter 2, it talks about how God's goodness is to point us to salvation. After we take our first breath, our second breath is a gift of grace by God. Amen? And so you take a third and a fourth and a fifth and a sixth. And then you come to the point where you understand good and bad, and then you choose to do bad. So at the point you become and understand sin, you are responsible. And so from that moment forward that you have another breath, God's goodness is trying to lead you to salvation. God doesn't guarantee anything in this life. Doesn't guarantee you to live to be 100. Doesn't guarantee you to live to be 10. But he does guarantee one thing, salvation by placing your faith and trust in Jesus Christ. That takes away your eternal risk. Your eternal risk, Matthew 16, verse 25. Jesus says this, for whoever's going to save his life is going to lose it. Whoever will lose his life for my sake will find it. This, we got to think of ourselves. We're like, this is where we need to be. I need Jesus. And so your first risk that you need to get rid of is your eternal risk. Once you place your faith and trust in Jesus, you have everything else you need. You don't need nothing more. That's the beauty of it. That's the beauty of knowing Jesus. In Matthew 6, Jesus says, don't worry about your life. What you're going to eat, what you're going to put on, what you're going to drink, none of those things. Don't worry about that. Don't make that the pursuit of your life is what he's saying. Yes, you got to eat to survive. You got to have water. I get it. He gets it. But the understanding is that God knows you have needs. God said, I will meet your needs. Don't worry about them. Why do we worry about stuff like that? Most of the time, that's what people come up with in life. What they're going to put on and where they're going to eat. Half of you are like, when's this bald guy going to shut up? Because I got to figure out where I'm going to eat. But the idea is, after you get rid of that eternal risk, there is no problem with you guys just living in the kingdom. The kingdom isn't here yet. It'll be here. It's not here yet, but it'll be on its way. But we live in God's kingdom where you have, as Ephesians 1:3 says, every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. You've got everything you need. There's nothing else that you have need of. And so Romans chapter 12, verse 1, Paul says, I appeal to you, brothers, by the mercies of God, present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. The word sacrifice means to kill or to slaughter. And we need to put to death our flesh. We need to martyr our flesh so that we can do the work for the kingdom, be a fellow worker in a battle, so that we can get the gospel out. Colossians 3:5 says, put to death, therefore, what is earthly in you. We need to be heavenly minded. When was the last time we actually sacrificed for the kingdom? When was the last time we took a risk? When was the last time we gambled with our lives to get the gospel out? When's the last time we took any kind of effort to present the gospel of Jesus to someone, to disciple them, to invite them to church? I mean, when you think about the greatest sacrifice, the greatest example was Jesus. And how much did he give? He gave it all. John chapter 15, verse 13. Jesus says, greater love has no one than this, than someone lay down his life for his friends. That's a sacrifice. 2 Corinthians 5, 14 and 15. Paul says, for the love of Christ controls us. That those who live may no longer live for themselves, but for him who for their sake died and was raised. If you've accepted Jesus, your eternal risk is gone. You don't need to worry about anything in this life. Matthew 6, Jesus said, God knows you have needs and he'll meet your needs. Not wants and desires, but your needs. So live in the kingdom. Go do the work of the kingdom. Jesus paid the price so that you are no longer a slave to sin, but you're a slave to him. Go live your life for him. His love should compel you to go live your life for him. That's that transformation. If Jesus laid down his life for us, then we should go live our lives for him, doing the work of the ministry. We need more examples of Christ. And maybe this morning, maybe you've never accepted Christ. Maybe you don't know what that means. Maybe you don't know what a Christian means. Maybe you don't know what it means to be saved. Maybe you don't know what it means to be born again. That's just Christian jargon. Well, the Bible makes it clear that unless you are born again, you won't see the kingdom of heaven. The Bible makes it crystal clear that unless you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you won't be saved. And so maybe you just need Jesus this morning. And so I invite you, when we have our invitation, whatever you need this morning, you come. Maybe you need to be a better example for Jesus. Maybe you need to be like-minded, have a genuine concern for others. Maybe you need to think on the things of Christ, not just your own. You need to be a co-worker. You need to be in a battle. You need to be sacrificing something. Whatever the case is, maybe you need help yourself this morning. Whatever your need is, I want to invite you to come. Would you stand with me? I'd ask every head bowed, every eye closed, no one looking around. I'm going to invite you to come this morning, friend. If you're here and you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, let today be the day of salvation.